Now, on behalf of WEC International, WEC UK and WEC Ireland, we want to welcome you all this evening to our service of celebration and thanksgiving. Some of you have come from just down the road, and others have come from quite a long distance away, from across the world, in fact. But it's a real privilege to have you together this evening, and have all of us together for this very specific purpose. And that purpose is to give thanks and to celebrate God's amazing grace in the life of our sister, Dr. Helen Roseveare. And our prayer is that we will, this evening, see Jesus in and through all that happens during the next hour and a half or so, and we'll be impacted afresh as we sense the heart of God too for a world where still so many desperately need to experience God's redeeming love. That's our desire, that's our passion for this evening. Let me begin first of all by saying a word of thanks. And that's important for an evening like this. A lot of things have gone on behind the scenes, a lot of people involved, and there are some that we want to specifically thank. I want to first of all thank the church here and their minister, Reverend David Johnson, for making the facilities available. Their facilities are lovely, and we do appreciate having the use of them this evening. To Mr. Tom Clark as well, chairman of the Bangor Worldwide Missionary Convention, for his help and advice in making this event happen too. Thank you. And to Paul and Emma Savage and the worship team for leading our worship this evening. It's a joy to have you along as well. And then right at the back, there's Johnny Sanlon from UFM and John Hamilton from WEC. They put together the videos that you will see this evening and the slides, and all, they've done lots of work for setting up the recording as well for this evening. And then, of course, there are others who work behind the scenes to help make an evening such as this run smoothly and enabling us to focus again on God and on his goodness and so on, and how he's worked through the life of Dr. Helen. And we thank each one of you. And it goes without saying that they all who work behind the scenes includes Paul and Julie Swaffield, National Directors of WEC here in Ireland. A big thank you to Paul and Julie too. We want to thank everyone who's going to be involved in the program this evening, and there are a lot of people taking part. Some through video and other ways, many people. And we want to thank each one for giving their time and energy with a servant spirit. And as Helen would have often said, it's a privilege to know and serve Jesus. Jesus is worth it. And if there's one thing we want you to take away this evening, it's that Jesus is worthy of our worship and worthy of our service. That's our desire. And then we want to thank every one of you for coming. This evening wouldn't work if you weren't here, and we thank you for coming along. It means a lot to us to have you here. So thanks to everyone, and we look forward to a great evening together. Now, there'll be no offering taken up during the service, but for anyone that would like to give towards the work of WEC International and the work in the Democratic Republic of Congo, there will be free will offerings boxes at the doors as you leave. Please feel free to contribute as you feel led. There's also refreshments at the end of the service, so if you're not in a hurry and you can wait around to chat and talk, they will be over here to the left. There will be refreshments out there in the multipurpose room and in the welcome area. And there's also some free literature and also books. Some of Helen's books are there for sale, so please take the time to have a look at those. My name is Philip Crooks, and along with my wife Jean, we have worked with WEC in Senegal, West Africa, also in the Netherlands, and then laterally in an international training ministry. So it's my privilege this evening to be chairperson for the evening and to lead us through this evening. So in a moment, the music band is going to lead us in a worship song, but before that, I'm going to invite Miss Maud Kales, who herself has been a missionary in the Democratic Republic of Congo for many years, to come and to lead us in prayer. Maud, thank you.
Let us pray. Dear Lord Jesus and most gracious Heavenly Father, we bow down in worship and adoration before you this evening, You who alone are the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, you are Almighty God, the great mighty creator of this universe and of our earth. And we thank you again for your great love for us. We thank you, Lord Jesus, how you left heaven's glory and came to earth for us. We thank you again for going all the way to the cross and for shedding your precious blood. And we, as we approach your throne this evening, we're conscious that we have failed thee in thought, word, and action, and we ask for your forgiveness afresh, and that you'll cleanse us anew in the precious blood of Jesus, and you'll keep us covered and protected by that precious blood, that you will pour out your Holy Spirit upon us this evening. We just commit the whole celebration to you. We pray that you will be honored and glorified in it. We know that that would be Helen's desire, is to glorify Jesus and to worship him. And so we just want to thank you again that not that your life didn't end on the cross, but you rose again from the dead. We thank you that you ascended to the Father's right hand. We thank you that even this evening you're interceding for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. How we worship you for that. We thank you that you've prepared a place for us, and thank you that you have given us that tremendous hope that one day we're going to meet face to face again in glory. We thank you for that tremendous hope. But Lord, we're here this evening to thank you for the life and witness and ministry of dear Helen. And we thank you for every memory of her. We thank you for her ministry here in Northern Ireland and in Congo and then right around the world. We just praise you and worship you for all that for her tremendous ministry in word and the ministry of your word and how she's touched so many hearts, particularly the young girls through Christian Girl Crusaders. And Lord, we thank you for the many young people and older people who are now in full-time service because of Helen. We just thank you, Lord. Return you thanks and praise. Thank you for all she did in the Congo. Thank you for her ministry there and how she so lovingly portrayed your love in practical ways and in the ministry as well. And she had training young doctors and nurses most of all, teaching them your word. And so we just praise you for the many pastors out there and those in your service out there in Congo this evening because of Helen. We thank you for every memory of her. We thank you here in Northern Ireland too, and how she so lovingly served you. And we always remember that beautiful smile and those lovely words, bless you, dear. And she was just such a lovely, lovely, such beautiful memories. And we thank you for every single one of them. We thank you for her ministry right around the world, right around in America, Australia, wherever she was, and how she touched so many hearts. But Lord, we know that her desire, if she was here this evening, she would say, don't praise me, praise Jesus. We know that was always her desire. And so we pray that you will be glorified and honored this evening in the meeting. We pray that by your Holy Spirit, you'll touch many, many hearts, each one of our hearts. Lord, we just long to hear your voice. And so we pray for John, we pray for Lewis, who will be ministering your word, that they'll know that anointing of your Holy Spirit upon them, that you'll truly bless them. And so, Father, and we thank you again for the ministry and song, and we pray that you will bless that as well. And so we just thank you for everyone who's come here, particularly Lewis, who's come all the way from Singapore, and we pray for your hand of blessing to be upon them. And so we just thank you again for Dr. Pat here, and thank you for all that she did for Helen. And we know that she just meant so much to dear Helen to have Pat by her side. And we just return you thanks for all that you've done. And we just really do want to give you praise and honor and glory, because we ask it in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
Hear the call of Christ our captain, for now that we
Now, in the course of our evening together, we will have a number of people who will pay tribute to Dr. Helen for her life and ministry and work for the kingdom of God. And the first one who's going to come this evening is John Bagg. John and Pauline Bagg are our UK directors, WEC UK directors, and it's a special joy to have John here with us tonight. John.
Well, good evening, everyone. Dr. Helen Roseveare, a doctor, a missionary, a WECer, a writer, and an international speaker. It's a great privilege to give this tribute on behalf of the WEC UK Fellowship to a wonderful lady who was absolutely committed to her Lord. She lived such a full life and crammed so much into it that it's impossible to cover it all in 10 minutes, and my prayer is just that what I do share both gives glory to God and is an accurate representation of all that she did. However, I'm sure that were it possible for Helen to be with us this evening, the one thing she would love us to do is give God the glory. And I hope as we go through this evening that that will be our experience, that we do indeed glorify the wonderful Lord Jesus. But on a personal level, I was greatly influenced when I first met Helen, not actually in the flesh, through her books and through her ministries. I joined WEC as a short-term worker in 1991, and when I turned up at the then headquarters, Bulstrode, I was given a box full of cassettes and books on living faith, living holiness, living sacrifice, and living fellowship, and I was told, read through these and I'll give you a talk in about a week's time. So I very dutifully read through the books and listened to all the cassettes as Helen poured out her heart as to what these core principles of WEC meant for her in practice. They were very basic orientation tools for new short-termers, but I devoured them. Because for the first time I was struck as a relatively new believer because she was describing a way of life that I'd never heard about before. In equal measure, it was both challenging, it was radical, but I saw in her life that it was fruitful. It was a model to be followed. That was back in 1991. The first time I met Helen in the flesh, as it were, was at an opening of the new WEC UK, WEC Ireland, Northern Ireland headquarters here in Portadown, where she spoke again with passion about the remaining unreached task as we had an opening ceremony of the new headquarters. The thing that struck me there was not just her passionate message and the way she shared about the challenges that still existed in the world for us to go out and share the gospel with the unreached peoples of the world, but I was also struck because in a big room, probably about the same size as this, she held up a very small visual aid, and I was sat at the back and I couldn't quite see it, and she was trying to stick things on it and it kept falling off. But what came across in that meeting and that remained throughout her life was her passion and her zeal and her encouragement, not just to do stuff for her Lord, but to encourage others to do likewise. More recently, she was attending a WEC conference, a WEC mission conference here, which I was speaking at and sharing about the changes that were going on in WEC, both internationally and in the UK. And at the end of the meeting, she came up to me. As those of you that know Helen will know, she is well able to do. She just laid her hand on mine and very gently but firmly looked me in the eye. And she said, "Keep things on track for Jesus' sake." So in the midst of all this change, there is still a passion to know Christ and to make him known. And then finally, on a personal level, one day, a few years ago now, as she was getting weaker, I received a phone call while I was working in the headquarters. And in this phone call, on the one hand, she was very excited. She says, "I'm getting ready to go home. I'm getting ready to meet my Jesus." But the reason she was ringing me is because she felt she ought to apologize, because she didn't feel that she was going to get to the end and finish her book. And she felt that she'd apologize to me that she wasn't finishing her book. It's one of those conversations I really didn't know what to say. I wonder whether I should I tell her off and tell her to press on? So I just reassured her to do what she can, and that was a wonderful conversation. At this point, on behalf of the WEC Fellowship, I would like to publicly thank all those who cared for Helen. She was a very precious WEC treasure. And I know that she was blessed by the love and care of so many, both within and beyond the WEC Fellowship. I'd particularly like to thank Dr. Pat Morton for all your support and love and care for Helen. Helen was born in 1925 in the south of England. She was obviously a very bright, intelligent girl from an early age who was always ready to express her opinion. It was on her 8th birthday that, having heard about children in India, she decided that she would be a missionary and tell other children about the Lord Jesus. However, it was not until 1945, whilst studying at Cambridge to be a medical student, that she actually became a Christian. So that desire and seed and zeal are things that God put into her and created her to be the woman she was. She once wrote in a Christmas letter about three things. The first was the one thing I know. I no doubt many of you will have received this Christmas newsletter. But she said, "About the one thing I know," Helen writes, "I am saved, that Jesus, God's holy Son, died to save me from the consequences of my sin and to make forgiveness available to me by faith." And all her adult life, she took opportunities to share that certain knowledge with others, whether it was one-to-one with individuals or from a public platform. In 1951, after graduating, she shunned the prospect of a more lucrative career at home and joined WEC International. And it was then that the Lord clearly called her to serve in Congo, to use her medical training, but also to share the good news of her Lord Jesus. She set up a hospital and medical training facility in Ibambi, and later another in Nebobongo. She also established 48 rural health clinics, and working with Mission Aviation Fellowship, she pioneered a flying doctor service. In her work, Helen combined training local women as nurses with training them to lead regular Bible studies. The nurses were prepared to both declare and demonstrate the good news and love of Jesus in their community. The second point in her Christmas letter was "One thing I do." And one of her favorite verses was, "Forgetting what is behind and straining towards what is ahead, I press on to keep on keeping on. No giving up, not thinking that I've done my bit and that now I can put my feet up." Perseverance was one of Helen's characteristics. Her perseverance was tested to the very limit during the Congolese Civil War. In 1964, the rebels finally reached Nebobongo, capturing her and her team. And for the next 5 months, Helen was held prisoner, enduring awful humiliation and brutality. Reflecting on this imprisonment later, she commented, "Fantastic, the privilege of being identified with our Saviour. He didn't take away pain or cruelty or humiliation. No, it was all there. But now it was altogether different. It was with him, for him, in him. Looking back, one has tried to count the cost, but I find it all swallowed up in the privilege. The cost suddenly seems very small." Mama Luca, she was affectionately known, spent another 7 years in Congo, following a short furlough. And when some others would have called it a day, she accepted a new challenge, and together with others started up a new hospital and training college in Niankunde. Finally, in 1973, Helen returned to the UK to look after her mother. This leads us to the third point in her letter, which she states, "There's one thing I ask." And she quotes from Psalm 27, "One thing I ask of the Lord, this is what I seek, that I may dwell in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to gaze upon the beauty of the Lord." In all the business and full schedules of her life, Helen desired a close walk with the Lord. She thirsted and longed to know him better and to be transformed more and more into his likeness. This close walk with the Lord not only kept her during the tough times already mentioned, but also in times of depression, disappointment, loneliness, and doubt, as when she returned from the Congo in 1973. But once again, Helen took solace in God, feeling that he was restoring her and preparing her for a new phase in her ministry. She began to share her experiences in Africa and her passion for Christian mission work to any who would hear. And through this, she became an internationally renowned author and speaker. As a speaker, for some 30 years, she traveled all over the English and French-speaking worlds, representing WEC and urging people to respond to God's call to mission. Helen particularly loved to speak to young people, church youth groups, high schools, university Christian unions, to challenge them to consider God's right to their lives and the privilege God offered them of missionary service all over the world. Helen's passion to encourage young people also led to her 50-year-long attachment to the Girls Crusaders Union. But even after 60 years of faithful service, Helen showed no wish to retire from ministry. Speaking just a few years ago, she expressed a desire to carry on serving God right until the end. "I love our Lord and Saviour," she says, "and his word more than ever. I just pray that as long as he continues to give me strength and reasonable health, I may have the privilege to continue to serve him. Whether that's in our local church, in our GCU family, in WEC, in outreach and challenge ministry, I long to see more and more young and not so young people catch the vision of the need of countless millions of people who have still yet to hear the gospel. Please pray that I will not give up before the end of the journey down here, and that I will keep close to the Lord and always be willing to share the truths of Scripture with anyone with whom I meet." What an intentional and purposeful way to live our lives. And as I was reflecting on this in preparing for this evening, I was greatly challenged, because we can look at Helen's life and we can think how wonderful, if only I could have a life like that. And the truth is that life is available to each and every person who will dedicate themselves to serve the Lord Jesus and to simply do the things he leads and guides and calls us to do. So to finish, I see Helen's testimony as both a great example of a life well lived and as a challenge to those of us who go after, to whom she has had and no doubt will continue to have an influence. She's blazed a trail. She has exhorted others to join with her. And she has now passed on the baton. And for Christ's sake, we can do no less today, not just to celebrate Helen's life and ministry and all that Jesus accomplished in and through her, but also to commit ourselves afresh, each one, whatever our age is, to pray to the Lord, to burn with zeal and passion for our Saviour and for his glory in the nations. It's our responsibility to pick up that baton and to run with perseverance the race that has been marked out for us. And so, Lord, as we gather together this evening, we thank you for the life of Helen. We give you the glory. And we cry out, Lord, lead us on. Take us into all that you've planned and prepared for us. And we yield our lives to you, for you are worthy. Thank you, Lord. Amen.
Thank you so much, John, for that tribute. As John indicated, and as most of us are well aware, Helen wrote many books, books which have been a tremendous blessing and will continue to be a blessing to many. And so it's a joy tonight to have Catherine McKenzie with us, who represents Christian Focus Publications, and she is now going to bring a tribute to Helen.
I've been asked to present you with a glimpse into a part of Helen Roseveare's life that certainly in the early Congo days would barely have featured in her thoughts, far less her plans. However, Helen's writings and mission through the printed word became a key part of her service to God and to the church. You could refer to her books as paper missionaries. And in fact, these are, even now, reaching out to generations that will outlive us all. With limited time to cover such an important part of her life, I've picked just four of her titles to reflect in some way her life with the pen. Give Me This Mountain was published 5 years before I was born. In Helen's own words, it's an honest, unadorned story of a somewhat tempestuous life. But its main aim was not to tell a drama, but to take the reader on the same journey that Helen had been on, a journey towards one definite and glorious goal, the Lord Jesus Christ. Followed in 1976 by He Gave Us a Valley, we see the personal request of Helen's first book answered in a different but better way. This is so often the case with our prayers and our God. We ask for things that we think are the great things, the mountains, the peaks, the glory. But in God, in His wisdom, He gives us the better portion, the valley and the shadow. We can mistakenly look at the valleys of our life in a negative way. However, as Helen was taught and indeed teaches us through her books, they are an integral part of God's plan as He takes us to the next peak. He has other and greater journeys for us to travel. Now, this brings me to another of Helen's books, because as well as climbing the mountains and the valleys, God sends us to the ditches. In 1973, Helen returned to the UK after 20 years of service in Africa. However, her missionary life was far from over. 2005 saw the publication of Digging Ditches. The famous Wellington boots on the cover illustrate the hands-on nature that was Helen's service to God. Be it in the Congo, with the young women of GCU, caring for her mother, fundraising for her church, or simply picking up a pen. The writing didn't stop there, as in 2011, a small book with a big voice was published, Enough. This pithy little title sums up so much of what I remember about Helen and the message of her life. Jesus was enough for her and is more than enough for her now. Helen's experience of Christ today is full and running over. There are no shortfalls or gaps. The ditches are dug and the water is gushing. Her book's available this evening in the bookstall. Teach us about the mountains, the valleys and ditches of our lives and spiritual experiences. Most importantly, they point us to Jesus. He's not only enough for us, in Helen's own words, he is worthy. And I think those are actually the last words I heard Helen say. She was sitting in the sun lounge in a bright yellow cardigan, and it was obvious that she was longing to be home with her Lord. And now she has received the Christian's great reward, well done, good and faithful servant. Now, earlier on, I referred to the generations that will outlive us, that people will read Helen's books long after her life and death, and I believe benefit from them. This is where you and I can be part of Helen's life and mission, part of God's work. The books on the book table are not just there for decoration. They're not just there for you to put on your shelf. They're there for you to buy, to read, and to pass on. Like I said, think of them as paper missionaries. Put these into the hands and minds of the next generation. Get your family and your church reading again. There are valleys and mountains to trek through, but there are also ditches to dig, minds and hearts to fill with the truth of Jesus Christ. So let's finish with a question Helen wrote towards the end of one of her books. Is the valley full of ditches yet? No, it's not. Well then, let's get digging. Thank you.
Thank you, Catherine. Helen's life and ministry had worldwide impact, and the tribute that I'm going to read in a moment comes from a couple in Canada with whom Helen had contact and with whom she worked in their ministry out there. Let me read what they wrote by way of tribute. We need to introduce ourselves as Ted and Dr. Nell Maxwell, founders of two national ministries in Canada, known as Women Alive and Men Alive in Christ. These ministries were established in 1973. The two ministries were organized to reach women and married couples with the goal to know Christ and make him known. Throughout its history, approximately 1 million people attended conferences, seminars, Bible studies, and a variety of programs aimed at encouraging attendees in their walk with God, as well as a strong evangelistic message with salvation as its goal. It was into this ministry that Helen came to Canada, as well as visiting the WEC headquarters in Hamilton. She spoke in conferences from the East Coast to the West Coast of Canada. We were blessed to have many outstanding godly speakers, but the one person that stood out was Dr. Roseveare. Her hallmark was that famous statement, "Thank you, Lord, for trusting me with this suffering, even though you may never tell me why." This statement, supported by Helen's traumatic experiences, gave validity to her messages and literally touched thousands of lives. The other spirit-filled message, which was so dynamic, was, "Not I, but Christ." The rotating platform at the University of Waterloo did not deter her in any way, as it circulated every 8 minutes. In a world that had gone off track, the Lord blessed her messages to speak to women, married couples, and men right across Canada. Helen's humility and her sense of humor endeared her to countless people and gave an emphasis to her messages. On one occasion, Helen confirmed that she would be the main speaker. As well, we had invited Anne Graham Lotz, daughter of Dr. Billy and Ruth Graham, and she had advised us that she would not be able to attend. she inquired as to who would be the other speaker. When she was told that Helen would be there, she replied, "I will come as well, because when I'm associated with Dr. Roseveare, I feel that I'm ministering beside an angel." At that conference, I heard a commotion at the back of the auditorium. When I inquired as to what happened, I was told that two sisters who had been adopted into two separate families and had been searching for each other for years discovered that they were sitting beside each other. Following that conference, my husband had to take books and other materials back to the office. Helen asked if she would go with Ted to pack the truck, since she was very adept at packing. Ted later mentioned that if Helen had not been there, it would have taken considerably longer to get everything into that van. In addition to her assistance with loading the vehicle, her company was such a blessing during the two-hour drive. At one point during the trip, Helen asked Ted if they could stop to buy a donut, to which Ted said, "Of course, we can buy a dozen." With a mischievous look in her eyes, Helen said, "I don't need a dozen. I only want one." Helen and I traveled to Western Canadian cities on a speaking tour. After each evening, I would offer her the honorarium, to which she simply replied, "I don't need the money. Please take the money and send it to that missionary to repair his car." On several other occasions, she did the same thing, reminding me that I was covering all expenses and various missionaries need the help. Helen was a brilliant doctor who we were honored to know as a personal friend. Her association with so many around the world was of a spiritual and medical nature. But for those who knew her as we did, she was a dear, precious friend. We spent long hours ministering and leisurely relaxing over many dinners. Helen's walk left a spiritual impact on our lives. Her special friendship with Dr. Pat Morton leaves an impact on so many of us. Helen admitted that she was not a good cook, yet she took the time to prepare picnic lunches with our daughter and her friend as they took long walks through the mountains. Helen's life could be summed up with a poem. "Give my words wings, Lord. May they alight gently on the branches of men's minds, binding them to the winds of your will. May they fly high enough to touch the lofty, low enough to breathe the breath of sweet encouragement upon a downcast soul." Dr. Roseveare, you stand today among those honored who give their lives to serve the risen Savior. Thank you, Helen, for your love, your servant heart, your humility, and your friendship. The words of Ted and Dr. Nell Maxwell from Canada. As we also indicated earlier, Helen touched not only the lives of older folk, as it were, but also younger folk. And so we're going to invite Heather Watson to come and bring a tribute on behalf of the Girl Crusaders Union, and then immediately afterwards, we're going to follow that with a video from Africa from the Reverend Mudabali, the president of the WEC-related churches in the Democratic Republic of Congo. First of all, then, Heather and friends, thank you.
What do you do on Sunday afternoons, Helen? The question was asked 70 years ago. And not being able to give a satisfactory answer, the 21-year-old medical student found herself, Bible in hand, cycling up the hill to her first experience of a GCU class, where she would soon be appointed assistant leader. Teaching the Bible to children and young people was what GCU was all about, and Helen loved the work. Her heart so longed to teach the young teens in her charge that she even organised an extra Saturday meeting in her garage. Many here will remember Helen's excitement and enthusiasm when communicating God's word to others. And teaching in GCU also gave opportunity to use her creative skills and love of diagrams to convey the truth.
Helen greatly impacted us through her teaching and memorable illustrations. Before the age of digital graphics, Helen planned and drew and coloured by hand visual aids to bring her lessons to life. She would often base her teaching over several weeks around a diagram that she would build upon each week to enhance the impact of her message. Some of you may be familiar with her Mount Everest illustration, where she used the stages in climbing that unique mountain as a parable of our Christian life. From base camp, corresponding to where we give our lives to Christ and start the Christian journey, right through to reaching the summit of the mountain, representing the ultimate goal to meet Jesus face to face and live with him eternally. And in between, all the stages of the journey where we need to prepare ourselves well, learn to use our equipment carefully, persevere through the hard times and discouragements, and above all, to keep our eyes on the goal, to keep us going and not give up.
In the 50s and 60s, Helen became one of a large number of girl crusaders serving God overseas, a number which was to grow to 860 over the years. As a missionary doctor in the Belgian Congo, later Zaire, she was not forgotten by the prayerful and missionary-minded family of GCU. The story of the hot water bottle has often been told. But 5 months before an orphan girl prayed, it was Betty Ponsford of the Bromley GCU class who added the unlikely gift to a parcel which her girls were preparing to send to Dr. Roseveare serving God on the equator. Back in the UK in the 70s, Aunt Helen happily involved herself in GCU once more, speaking at classes, rallies, conferences, and summer camps, including training school camps for young women preparing for Christian service. Indeed, Helen's role in camp was to extend right up to August 2010, when she was again used to speak to lives at a camp for older teens in Ganaway, Northern Ireland. But don't think that our esteemed and internationally renowned speaker was aloof from the lives of modern girls.
Helen loved to enter fully into all the camp activities, especially those with an element of competition, when her creative spirit and brilliant mind would inspire and encourage her team or her dorm group to work together to gain the maximum points. Whether it be building a sandcastle or winning a party game, her infectious enthusiasm and competitive streak made girls of all ages want Dr. Helen in their team. I remember, too, a camp outing to the Pass of Killiecrankie, standing with a group, looking down at the map on the ground, depicting the spectacular leap of a soldier across the River Garry as he escaped his enemies. For Helen, it was not enough to simply imagine and be impressed by the distance. She had to attempt the jump, not, I hasten to add, across the river. Unusually, though, she failed and landed on her knees, her immediate and only concern that one of us would report back to Pat that she'd been foolish enough to try. The message of Helen's life at camp and her more formal Bible teaching were one and the same. Let us throw off everything that hinders. Let us run with perseverance the race marked out for us, looking unto Jesus.
1980 to 81 saw the second missionary forward movement of the Union. In Helen's own words, a time of renewed impetus, renewed hope, and renewed determination to be faithful to our God-given task. Who better to lead the work than Helen herself? Over the year, she had the joy of visiting every class in Britain and Ireland, speaking at assemblies and CUs in 28 schools, holding prayer days with leaders, meetings with parents, teens and 20s events, residential weekends, a total of over 400 meetings and many miles of travel.
Those many miles were covered in a bright yellow Fiat 127. Helen's talks were equally vivid and memorable, and all was applicable to the leaders, whether it was a small group in a leader's home or a huge gathering in a large assembly hall, whether it was a bunch of excited campers or a quiet day for experienced leaders. She might use an acrostic like GCU, or at camp's reunion that year, it was the word forward. She might have a visual aid, such as a dirty lantern that needed its glass cleaning, or a rose, a beautiful rose, which she stripped to turn it into a sharp arrow, or paint that had to be stirred if it was going to be fit for purpose. And for the final series of meetings, she had a set of traffic lights that worked. Stop, listen, and go. But at one stage, the yellow car was its own visual aid. It refused to go into reverse. Its underlying message was still that with Jesus, there's no turning back as we press on toward the goal for the prize of the high calling in Christ Jesus. Or as Helen herself said, keep on keeping on. We believe that many lives were transformed by the Lord that year.
By now, Helen had made her home in Belfast, and when she didn't have speaking engagements elsewhere, was helping regularly in local and some not so local GCU classes. Lisburn, Bangor, Ballymoney, Eglinton and Ballyclare all benefited from her willing and committed assistance, often alongside her dear friend, Dr. Pat Morton, and sometimes in situations which would otherwise have struggled to keep going. She joined Pat in the leadership of the NOC class, and there befriended, taught and prayed for girls over three decades. Her influence is not forgotten.
We will never forget the love, kindness and commitment shown to us as teenagers, but most of all, we will never forget her love and passion for Jesus.
As leader of GCU at NOC, where I came to know Jesus for myself, an inspirational and lovely lady whose love for Jesus was so clear to see.
The warmth of her love that oozed from her every time you saw her, followed by, bless your heart.
Remember your leaders, those who spoke to you the word of God. When I think of her, this verse comes to mind, an inspiration in so many ways and the coolest person to invite to a midnight feast at camp.
And this from a serving missionary. She taught me more than anyone else about the Bible and about topics relating to faith. She was incredibly humble and just radiated the love of Christ.
I remember her faithfully teaching us on Sunday afternoons and how her face shone with love for the Lord. She cared so deeply about our lives and our spiritual walk with Christ.
For almost 30 years, Helen served as Honorary Vice President, then President of the Girl Crusaders Union. She felt the privilege and honour of the position. She fulfilled it with humility and devotion. When the decision was taken to close GCU in 2010, you can imagine, therefore, the grief and sore disappointment that Helen felt. She took the opportunity to record a message to every one of the leaders in the work. Here is a snippet from that message.
And if I can just remind you of our GCU motto. We all know it, Ephesians 2:8-9. It is by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not from yourselves, it is the gift of God. Not by works, so that no one can boast. But then we stop. And now we need to read the next verse, for it's all part of the one section. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works. Not that we're saved by good works, we all know that's not true. But if we are saved, we have to do the good works. And what are these good works? To do good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. Isn't that a wonderful promise? He's already prepared for every single one of you, as much as for me, what's the next step? And every door that closes is really a door opening to the next step. And sometimes if we don't allow the door to close, we can't get into the next step. I can remember at my 80th birthday party, getting an email from a friend who was just 10 days older than me. Many of you will know him by name, Dick Lucas, saying, don't forget, as you join the Octogenarians Club, that there's one word that's forbidden, and that's the word retirement. There's no retirement in God's work until there's not a single person left who hasn't heard the gospel. And while we've got breath to teach about Jesus and to share Jesus with others, we've still got a job to do.
We thank God for the uniquely talented and capable lady he brought into our GCU family and into our lives. We thank him for the passionate Bible teacher who was herself teachable to the end. We thank him for countless lives influenced for eternity through Helen in GCU. We thank him for the inspiration of a life well lived, and pray that the grace of God, which worked so evidently in her life, would work also in ours.
The president of the WEC related church, Sekase, in the Democratic Republic of Congo. I would like to give testimony as president on behalf of the community of the Sekase, the community in which our sister Helen Roosevelt served the Lord. For us, in the Sekase, she was a model of Christ. Christ had as objective to go to Golgotha to save us. It was the same for Helen Roseveare. When she experienced the new birth in Christ, God sent her to the Congo. She received the call to come and serve in the Congo. Despite the difficulties of that time, she kept straight on to reach her objective. What was that objective? It was to help the people of the region with medical care by starting the hospital at Nebobongo, which is today one of the biggest hospitals in the region. She didn't stop there. She trained people like Papa Mangadima. She trained others like Papa Balani, who works in Poko. Even in later life, she trained our specialist surgeon, Dr. Jean-Claude. Because of these things, she remains for us a model Christian. She remains a monument by what she has been able to do in the Congo. She has left an unforgettable testimony. The Sekase, the Congo, will never forget Helen Roseveare. To God, she is now at rest with the Lord, but we have great memories of her and what she has done, and she will always be a model Christian and a monument that will continually speak to future generations that she was for us a blessing for this country. May her soul rest in peace, and may the church, the mission wake, be blessed. This is on behalf of the President, Pastor Modibale, President for the Sekase.
Pastor Modibale, President de la Sekase.
Thank you so much, Heather, and friends from GCU, and also the President of the Sekase 16 Church in Congo, Pastor Mudimali. Now, it's a delight this evening to have Paul and Emma and the worship band with us. And Emma's going to bring us a solo, after which then there will be another tribute from Africa, from Jean-Claude Batineni, the surgeon at Nebobongo. And then immediately after that, the music band will lead us all in another worship time together. So first, Emma is going to bring us a solo.
Yes, my name is Jean-Claude Batineni, and I am a physician. I'm actually a surgeon serving at Nebobongo Hospital. And I am the son of the nurse, Batineni Theodore, who worked at Nebobongo Hospital. And he was actually trained by Helen Roseveare, and even my mom also got some training as a midwife by Helen Roseveare. So I have known about Dr. Helen Roseveare, that we call here Mama Luca, since my very young age. Even though I was born when he was already gone, but I knew about her, and the last time that she came here in 2004 for the opening of the operating room, which bears her name. That's when really I got to see her, to meet with her, and we get to know each other very well. So it's also during that time that we discussed, and I was chosen to go to get some further training in surgery. And Helen Roseveare, Mama Luca, and myself, I used to call her Grandma, she really got involved for my training. So I was trained in Gabon for 5 years of surgery, general surgery. What do I know from her? I know that she was a lady of faith, and she loved to care about people, praying for people. I remember her writing us emails every time when I was in my training in Gabon, and every single email was just like to encourage us. And most of the time was always, keep on keeping on doing such like good things. Keep on keeping on, serving God. And that's something I've been carrying everywhere, just to know that once you start, or once you commit yourself to work for God and with God, you have to keep on keeping on, because it's not easy. I remember when she came in 1989, she made a documentary, and she said her dream, or she dreamed before, just like seeing one day Neighborbone being run by local people, and seeing just the work going very, very well, just like it used to be when missionaries were. And that's something I always feel like what we are doing now here in Ebo Bongo is like the fulfillment of that dream. Because for right now, the hospital is fully run by Congolese, and I know we do need and get outside help, but we are now functioning just as well as when we had missionaries, and we can tell by seeing people valuing what we are doing. So that is the legacy of Grandma Mama Luca for this place. The hospital has to stay focused on treating people physically, but we have also to care more and more about the spiritual part. And that's something we say to honor what she did, what the others did. We have to keep on serving God in this hospital. Mama Luca, Grandma Dr. Helen Roosevelt being gone makes us feel a bit sad, but we are very thankful. We miss her being there as our counselor, asking about this hospital, being so like a prayer warrior. But what we know is that she left a great legacy of, she set a good example that we will always follow. Like, serve your God with your heart, with everything that you have, and also to be concerned about the patients and for the care, not only physical care, but we will also make sure for this hospital to always proclaim the kingdom of God. And I think that's the way we can make sure we keep the legacy that Helen Roseveare, as the pioneer of this hospital, wanted to be. And she would like that to happen every day. So we will never abandon that system of doing things.
Let's stand.
Thank you again to Emma and to the band for that solo and for leading us in worship, and also to Jean-Claude for his testimony to Helen too, and all that he appreciates through her life and influence in his life. Now we come to a very special moment in the evening, and this is a video of Helen herself sharing with us a message, something that she leaves for us to think about and take away with us. So let's listen to Helen on this video as she speaks.
when I, my first year at university, I had Christian friends who tried to get hold of me. They knew I wasn't a Christian, and they wanted, invited me to go to meetings and go to their Bible studies and things. And they then organized for me to go for a camp at Christmas. And I heard the gospel. I heard the truth that God so loved me as an individual. He knew me by name, so loved me that he sent his son Jesus to die for me, for my sins, that I could have. I was so captivated by the wonder of this story. And I can only say that really, that night when I first heard the gospel, I fell in love with Jesus. And that has been my motivation ever since. That has never changed for me. It's always the wonder of the fact he so loves us. He came down from heaven to our mucky old earth and live amongst us mucky old people in order to save us. And I know from the very first night that I was saved, I had this overwhelming desire. I wanted to serve him. I would do anything he asked. I'd go anywhere he sent me. I wanted to let him know I loved him because he so loved me. And that has honestly never changed. It's come in different circumstances, come through different ways, but always the root motivation in me that brought me into WEC and kept me there and took me out to Congo and kept me there. It's always been this tremendous love of God for us individuals, that we might so love others with his love that they too would come to know forgiveness of sins. All of us have the privilege of being called to be his servants. That's just so wonderful. Where Jesus said he himself did not come to be served, but to serve and to give. And if we had this in the back of our hearts all the time, we're not being called to some big outward thing or thing that we've written about or publicized, but that we're called to serve him. And we serve him because we love him. Then whatever we're doing for Jesus and doing for him to be uplifted. I think that would be my major thing I'd like to leave with young people today, to think in those terms of putting Jesus first. And when there's a problem, and when you really feel you really reached the end of your tether, he's there. He knows, he's been through it all, and he's there to encourage you and strengthen you and help you and prompt you all the way, that even if you can't see any point in what you're doing, and if it doesn't seem, sometimes it does seem pretty pointless, but nevertheless, it's for him. And he knows what he's doing and why. And it just does all fit in. It's amazing. Yes, I would like to leave with all of you. When I first came to know that Jesus loved me, that first night at camp, and I was given a Bible, which I'd never had before, and the leader of the meeting wrote in my Bible, Philippians 3, verse 10. And he wrote the reference in, and then he said the words to me. He said, I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection and the fellowship of sharing in his sufferings. And he said to me, he said, tonight you've come to the beginning of that verse. I want to know Christ. He says, my prayer for you in the years that lie ahead is that you come to know more and more the power of his resurrection. And then very quietly, looking straight at me, he said, maybe one day God will give you the privilege of sharing in the fellowship of his sufferings. I'd been a Christian about an hour, and here I was being told that it was a privilege to suffer. And yet as I look back, I can say, thank you, God, that you gave me that the first night that I was saved, that it is a privilege to share in the sufferings of Christ, however they come, whatever level they are, and that he's just so good. And that word privilege became very precious to me ever since, that it's privilege. And when you're having a tough struggle, when things aren't going according to plan, when, as a surgeon, you could say, in the middle of an operation, and you just don't know what to do next, and nobody to help you. At those moments, whatever it is, it'll be different for each one of us. But in that minute, it's a privilege. It's a privilege you're sharing with him in some part of the suffering. And as you say privilege in your mind, the burden lifts. And you suddenly realize, how wonderful that God is willing to choose me to give me the privilege of serving him. And I've just shared that my right now, as I'm conscious that I am old, and people ask me in church, how are you? And I just tend to say, well, I'm old. But and as you get older and the memories go and you become forgetful and you can't think of words, you can't recognize people or names, but it's all privilege. And just each time get back onto it, it's God's privilege. And I mean, there's no question, but in these last few months, I have had a growing urge, a longing for him to call me that I can go home. But he hasn't chosen to. I'm still here. And I mean, well, he's got a job. People say to me, well, he's got a job for you, that's why you're here. He hasn't finished with you yet. I know, but I don't find it easy to rejoice in that, but it's privilege. It's privilege to be still here. And he is choosing the when. And I just leave that with older friends. Keep on trusting right to the end.
Well, as Helen reminds us, and as you look around at the banners around the church, you can see that word privilege. It's all privilege. And that's what we want to remember and take away from us, take away with us rather this evening. Now, it's a very special privilege this evening to have Dr. Lewis Sutton with us, the International Director of WEC. He's come all the way from Singapore, where along with his wife Susan, they head up the WEC International team. And Jean and I had the privilege for a number of years to work under the leadership of Lewis and Susan, and that was a great experience. Prior to Singapore, Lewis and Susan worked in Chad, and then as US WEC directors in Philadelphia, and then now as international directors. Lewis, it's a real privilege to have you this evening, and we trust that God will use you to speak to all our hearts.
Thank you, Philip. Thank you all for the privilege of being here. And let's start by looking at the word that Helen loved so much. Just to read a brief passage that will come into this message near the end. It's from Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1, verses 27 through 29. Hear the word of the Lord. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then, whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in one spirit, contending as one man for the faith of the gospel, without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you. This is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. For it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for him. Let's pray. Jesus, we want to see you tonight. We want to see you through the word. We want to see you through Helen Roseveare and her testimony. Lord, help us. Help me in my words. Help us as listeners. This hour of the night, we pray you'll still speak to our hearts and open our eyes to see you afresh. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, Helen Roseveare, she spoke on many different themes, didn't she? And she's told many stories, and she used many different words, sometimes words on more than one occasion. But if you were to say there is one word that Helen Roseveare used over and over again, one word that she counted as precious, one word that characterized a theme for her life, maybe Dr. Pat could tell us better, what would you say that word was? That one word that really was at the heart of Helen Roseveare. Well, you could say a lot. I'm sure Jesus is kind of always the answer. Bless your heart. I've heard tonight she would say bless your heart. But I think it would be that word, privilege. Privilege. It came out in this video tonight. For her, privilege was a very precious word, she said. She talked of the privilege of serving Jesus and the privilege of being a missionary, a privilege of being a medical doctor, privilege of taking the gospel to people who had never heard of Jesus Christ. But you know, Helen, she also talked of privilege in a much deeper and more profound way, didn't she? She talked of privilege in the midst of suffering and pain. She talked of the privilege of sharing in the suffering of Jesus. And of course, if any of you know Helen and have heard her stories, all of you have heard even reference tonight to this kind of most brutal moment of her suffering, which was during the Congo Rebellion when she was taken by soldiers and beaten and lost her teeth and was raped and brutally attacked. And then she says, of course, you've heard this quote, that in the midst of the darkness and loneliness, she says, he, Jesus, met with me. And in his love, he breathed a word into my troubled mind. And the word was privilege. And as John Bagg made reference to earlier, he didn't take away the pain or cruelty or humiliation. No, it was all there. But now it was altogether different. It was with him and for him and in him. It was privilege. Now that is privilege in the deepest sense, the most profound sense. And that's, in a sense, what I would like to do in this message tonight, is talk about what was it, what was that privilege that she felt so deeply, that biblical privilege that she somehow had discovered the secret of, biblical privilege. Well, privilege, of course, is a word, you know, we all use the word privilege. We use it lightly sometimes. Philip used it, you know, a privilege to be here, privilege to introduce me. I could say, yeah, it's a privilege to be here tonight. I could say it's a privilege for me to be the first time in Northern Ireland, eat fish and chips right here in Northern Ireland. It's a great privilege. And we use that word fairly lightly, though. It's kind of, in that sense, privilege means it's nice, something nice. I really enjoyed being here and doing this thing. But there is a deeper sense, kind of a medium-level sense of privilege, when we talk about privilege as an honor. This is an honor that not everyone gets to do. And I think you would all, those of you who have known and worked with Helen Roseveare, you would call it an honor, a privilege to have known her, something that not everybody has gotten to do. But it is an honor, a privilege, a special gift to those of us who have known Helen, who have heard her speak. And it was a privilege for me and Susan, my wife. She was not my wife at that time. We were university students. We went to a big student Christian conference called Urbana in 1976. And there was Helen Roseveare speaking. A huge auditorium, 17,000 students. And here was little Helen on the stage. And as usual, she had a visual aid. And her visual aid was, I think, like the rose somebody mentioned. She, on stage, she had a big tree. As she talked about her suffering and her pain and the difficulties that she had gone through, she spoke of the cost of declaring his glory. And one by one, she broke off a leaf or a branch or the bark. And one by one, as we sat mesmerized by this lady speaking of the suffering, then in the end, at the end of her talk, all was left was this shaft, this trunk of this tree left lonely and alone on the stage. And then at the end of the talk, she picked it up and put an arrowhead at the top of it, and she held it up for all of us to see. And then she, of course, read this verse, which was very prominent in her speaking. She often spoke of Isaiah 49, 2 and 3. He made me into a polished arrow and concealed me in his quiver. He said to me, "You are my servant, Israel, in whom I will display my splendor." And that night she went on to talk of the cost of declaring his glory. And she looked and she said at the end of that, this quote that John Bagg said, "Looking back, one has tried to count the cost, but I found it all swallowed up in privilege." The cost suddenly seemed very small and transient in the greatness and permanence of the privilege. Well, you know, to us, the 17,000 students who were listening to us, you know, the cost didn't seem very small and transient that night. The cost seemed huge. And yet somehow, in the way that she talked about it, in the way that she expressed it, there was something that rose in our hearts to that challenge. And so Susan and myself and thousands of other students, when Billy Graham gave the invitation, this time not an invitation to salvation, but an invitation to missions, we stood up and said, "Yes, we will do whatever, Lord, you want. Go wherever you want to be a part of what you're doing." And somehow, even in that suffering, the cost of declaring his glory, it had not discouraged us from being a missionary. It was interesting, some years later, when I was with Helen Roseveare, she was at WEC USA, and we were having a tea together, and I said to her, "You know what, Helen, it must be encouraging to be always encouraging people to go into missions." She said, "No, that's not what I do." She said, "I discourage them from going to missions." She said, "Then if God really calls them, they're really called. But my gift is discouragement." Well, I'm not sure that's really true, because somehow in the depth of even sharing about her cost and the difficulties, somehow something came through where you saw and you tasted this idea of privilege. Somehow it was privilege for her. And you know, the definition, if you look at the definition of privilege, the simple definition of privilege, I would say is the gift, being given the gift or the honor of doing something valuable that not everybody gets to experience. So that's my simple definition, but it's the gift of doing something valuable that not everybody gets to do. So it is something valuable. You don't call it a privilege to do something nobody wants to do anyway. Don't try to tell your children that, "Yeah, it's a privilege to do homework tonight." It's not a privilege to do something that everybody gets to do. I couldn't say to you tonight, "You know, we're going to come to this church tonight, and it's going to be a great privilege for us to all breathe tonight." In a superficial sense, yes, that's always true. But in a sense, privilege is being able to do something valuable that's not accessible to everyone. It's the gift of doing something. And so I think Helen probably, she understood that. I'm sure deeply she understood that. But I think Helen understood it at even a deeper level, a biblical sense of what privilege is all about. Helen understood. The Apostle Paul understood. The Macedonian church, you know, the Macedonian church in 2 Corinthians, they asked for the privilege. But they said in verse 2, Paul, speaking of the Macedonian church, says, "Out of the most severe trial, overflowing joy and extreme poverty, they urgently pleaded with us for the privilege of sharing in this service." Now, I think most of us, if we were in a severe trial of extreme poverty, we wouldn't count it a privilege to be able to give away money. And yet somehow the Macedonians had caught that. And I think most of us, if we were in the midst of being beaten and brutally treated, we wouldn't necessarily embrace that word privilege like Helen did. So what was it? How is it that she and Paul and the Macedonians could count it as privilege? Well, if you look at privilege in the basic sense, that first part of it, privilege is doing something valuable. Well, I think you would agree with me that the value of what you do could be increased to the degree that what you do is a part of something bigger. So if you're doing something small, but if it's a part of something bigger, the value of what you're doing is more valuable. It's more of a privilege. I'm a medical doctor like Helen Roseveare, and worked in Africa like Helen did, and worked at a little hospital, a little rural hospital, no electricity, no running water. Sometimes I'm not a trained surgeon, but sometimes had to do surgery. Fortunately, I had a book on how to do surgery, and I was the only doctor for 175,000 people, so I had no choice. And if I had to do surgery at night, we had a little operating room in this hospital. We didn't have any electricity, but we had a little Honda generator, you know, one of these pull cord generators. And so
we would start up that generator and it would run the operating room lights for the operation. And on this one night, I was at night doing an emergency C-section, a cesarean section, you know, delivering a baby, and had just delivered the baby, was handing the baby off the operating room table to the nurses to take care of. And this is a very critical part of the operation now. You need to sew and sew quickly. And all of a sudden, the generator went out, completely dark. No, we don't have emergency lighting or backup generator or anything. Just, I couldn't even see my hands in front of my face. And so these senior nurses, they're all over by the generator trying to get it start, Nothing's working. And so I'm just sitting there praying. And one of the junior nurses, one of the young men that was in training, he slipped out of the operating room door and went down the hall to the patient's room and got a torch. We call it flashlight, but a torch, and came back in the room, click, and held the torch over my shoulder. And for the rest of the operation, he stood there and just held the torch to enable me to finish the operation. Now, at the end of the operation, everything went fine. The baby was fine. The mother was fine. We were all happy. I was smiling. The other nurses, the senior nurses, were smiling. But you know who had the biggest smile in that room? That junior nurse who was holding the torch. Because he had been a part of something bigger than himself. It had been something small, not something, some huge act. It was just holding a torch. And yet that torch had been a part of something bigger, and somehow that became privilege. That became something bigger in itself because it contributed to the bigger picture. And this is, I think, a part of the key to Helen's profound sense of privilege, was that she was captivated by this glorious goal that Catherine mentioned earlier, a glorious goal. And we heard it in her video. Her heart was, she said, I just want Jesus to know how much I love him, for him to be uplifted, to show that Christ is worthy. So this was what the heartbeat of Helen Roseveare was all about, to show Christ is worthy. And that's what this passage, Paul is yearning in this passage, Philippians 1. He says, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. So whatever you do, make sure the end goal is that Christ is worthy, that the gospel is shown to be worthy. And this was Helen's heartbeat. This was her cry that Christ would be shown to be worthy. You know, in WEC, we have policies like every other organization. And interesting, in our finance policy, point 3 of the finance policy, kind of buried is this wonderful phrase that I love, and I think Helen would have loved. This policy came out after Helen had stepped out of active service in WEC. But this point says, Christ is worthy of our absolute trust. And I love that phrase, because it doesn't say we absolutely trust him. We might, sometimes we doubt, sometimes we waver, but Christ is worthy of our absolute trust. Whether we trust him fully or not at the moment, Christ is always worthy of our absolute trust. And this was Helen's glorious goal. And she didn't succumb to the temptations of career. She was a Cambridge-educated physician or financial security. She could have. And those are the temptations of our world as well today. Think about me and my needs and my reputation. But she was captivated by this higher goal. And so, as she said, everything that contributed to that goal was swallowed up in privilege. And of course, the greater the goal, the more likely that smaller act that contributes to that goal will be seen as privilege. And of course, you know this famous quote from David Livingstone, another physician, from Scotland, who went to Africa, and at the end of his life, somebody said, how could you have made so many sacrifices? And he said, you know, I never made a sacrifice. How could I call it sacrifice when other men serve lesser kings and call it privilege? And so Helen, I think the first key to Helen's profound sense of privilege was this glorious goal that Helen was captivated by. And the second key and the last key was not the glorious goal, but was a gracious gift. You know, if small things like holding a torch can contribute to this glorious goal, how much more valuable will something deep and profound that contributes to this glorious goal? And that is, I think, the gift that Helen was given. Helen was given, Apostle Paul was given, and that's what he's talking about here. He says, whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel. And then he says, this is a sign. This is a sign to them. Well, what is the this? Well, we're coming to that. But it's a sign to them. Who's the them? It says, to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved. So this sign is to unbelievers. You know, those of us who work among unreached peoples, among difficult religious groups, people are blinded. And we think, so how will they ever see the truth? What will open their eyes? What will penetrate the darkness? And here it is. Here's the sign, that a darkness-penetrating sign that will show them that they are going to be destroyed and that you will be saved. And what is it? And he says in verse 29, for, or because, it has been granted to you. And that verb in the Greek, it has been granted to you, actually means it has been given to you a gracious gift. So this is a gift for you. This is a privilege that has been given to you. It has been granted to you what? On behalf of Christ, not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for him. So what is that gracious gift? What is that darkness-penetrating sign? It's to believe and to suffer together. Not just believing and not just suffering, but believing and suffering together, being able to trust in the midst of suffering, like Helen Roseveare. And God gave Helen Roseveare that gracious gift. He gave her believing and suffering together. And that was very powerful. You know, for me, I think if God was offering me that gift, I think I would say, just give me the first half of that gift. You know, I don't want to be greedy. You just give me the believe part of the gift. You give the suffering part to somebody else. I don't need the whole gift. I'll just honor Christ by prosperity and blessings and everything going well, and then I'll show that Christ is worthy. But Christ says there, Paul says there's a deeper way, and that is a gift. If he has granted you that gift like he granted to Helen, and I think like Helen said, he gives that gift into whatever measure. He gives it to some the gift of profound suffering like he gave to Helen, and others lighter. But if he gives you that gift of suffering and believing together, that is a gracious gift, and it can be very powerful. Because if you believe in the midst of suffering, if you have joy that remains in the midst of suffering, if you have lost something, your physical health, your comfort, your finances, if you've lost something and still have joy in the midst of that loss, it means that there is something more valuable that remains. And it points to that which is more valuable. And it points to Christ, to the greater treasure. Christ is worthy of our absolute trust. That's the secret of the buried treasure, isn't it? You know, the man sold everything he had, and in his joy, he went and bought that treasure. And I think, here he is. How could he have joy when he just lost everything? Well, of course, it's an easy answer, because what he was to gain is of so much more value than what he was to lose. And that's the secret of the Hebrews, who lost their property. Joyfully, you joyfully accepted the confiscation of your property. Why? How could they joyfully accept the confiscation? Because you knew that you yourselves had better and lasting possessions. That gracious gift was suffering and believing put together. And that contributed to the glorious goal. And that was what Helen counted as privilege. Helen Roseveare was captivated by a glorious goal. She wanted Jesus to know how much she loved him. She wanted Jesus to be uplifted. She wanted Jesus to be known that he was worthy of our absolute trust. She wanted unreached peoples to know that Christ was worthy of their absolute trust. And because she was captivated by that glorious goal, God gave her a gracious gift. And that gracious gift was suffering and believing together. My prayer is that we also would be captivated by that same glorious goal of Christ being known. And if we are captivated, if that captures our heart, not our own selves, then God might give you a gift. And that gift might be suffering and believing. But if it's suffering and believing together, then Christ can be shown to be worthy of absolute trust. He can be shown to be the absolute treasure. And then you and I will count that as privilege. Let's pray.
Lord, we are stirred by Helen. We're stirred by your word. Lord, give us the privilege, I pray, of contributing to your worthiness. Give us the privilege, Lord, even if it means suffering and believing, somehow to point to you as our greatest treasure, like Helen did, so that you will be known to be worthy. We thank you for your love for us and your testimony through the life of Helen. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thank you so much, Lewis, for sharing those words with us. Much appreciated indeed. Now we're going to have a final worship song, and then immediately afterwards, I'm going to invite the Reverend Tim Anderson, Rector of St. Elizabeth's in Dundonald, to come and close our time together in prayer. St. Elizabeth's was Helen's home church. And remember, if you can, please stay, chat with us. Maybe you'd like to talk to someone who shared something this evening. Maybe God has spoken to you. Please do take the opportunity to come and talk with someone. Thank you. Let's worship God together, and then Tim will come and pray.
Drives us to our knees. Brothers and sisters, please do be seated. And just before I lead us in a closing prayer, again, some words from Helen. How actually did it all begin? How did Helen come to fall in love with Jesus? This is how she describes it. It's Christmas 1945 in West London. With an overwhelming sense of failure and helplessness, I cried out to God, if there was a God, to meet with me and to make utterly real and vital to me himself. I raised my eyes and through my tears read a text on the wall, be still and know that I am God, Psalm 46, verse 10. That was all. Immediately, the whole burden fell away in a moment. Be still and know God, whose name is I Am. Be still and know him. Stop going to this one and that. Stop striving to understand with the intellect. Just be still and know him. In that moment, a great flood of peace and joy and unutterable happiness flooded in, and I knew that he and I had entered into a new relationship. I knew God, and I knew in that moment that all the theories were true and somehow he would work them out for me. The steady reading of scripture in the previous months, the careful listening to doctrinal teaching had prepared the way. For years, the Holy Spirit had been opening my eyes to a sense of sin, convicting me of my unworthiness before a holy God. But now came the wonderful gift of repentance. God poured out his grace in forgiveness, in cleansing from all the uncleanness of sin, and in revealing at this time the amazing wonder of the friendship of Christ. And so started for me the thrilling journey of the Christian pilgrimage through this earthly life towards a heavenly eternity. And some favorite words of Helen's. Philippians 3, whatever gain I had, I counted as loss for the sake of Christ, that I may know him and the power of his resurrection, and may share his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Almighty God, dearest Father, we give you great thanks tonight for the glorious message, the good news, and the eternal gospel of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. He has died for our sin in our place, taking our punishment. He has been raised from the dead, defeating our death, securing life in all of its fullness. He reigns now in heaven, giving strength to us in our weakness by his Holy Spirit. And he will come again when all creation in heaven and earth will see him and every knee shall bow. So thank you, Almighty God, Heavenly Father, for this wonderful truth of the gospel. And as we continue to give you praise for your servant Helen, we pray for ourselves what she prayed for herself soon after her conversion. Stir me, dear God, to live for you in the very fullest sense by the faith of your dear Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Stir me that I may step out of the apathy and indifference and lethargy that seek to overwhelm our society in self-sufficiency and self-complacency. Stir me to move out into the exciting realm of faith, to see Jesus Christ at work in all the daily details of living. Give me the courage to believe and to act in faith. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.